Lowrider V3 CNC plus fluid NC dial pendant equals you need a printed cradle. A Spinny Murder Robot production brought to you by Design 8 Studios, studio.
Hey, you said studio twice.
Obviously. Hey, this is Doug with Design 8 Studio, and in some of my recent videos you've seen the fluid dial from Fluid NC. The dev team is still working on the software. This is literally still in development now, but they're working quickly on it, and I've been helping where I could, but I really need a place to put this. And so my thinking is to attach a holder for it here. So I've designed this 3D printed holder, and it's intended to have small round magnets in it. And I'm gonna print another base that has sockets for small magnets on the back of it. I'm gonna use a 5/64 drill bit to pre-drill for these. Okay, so I've actually printed multiple iterations of the base. First was the original base, and then there was a deeper version of it because I needed 7 more millimeters of depth. And then there was a modification of that one that was made for magnets. And the first prototype of the cradle worked okay, but I wasn't really satisfied with it. So I've come up with another iteration of the case, the bottom part of the case. And this one is made to have 8 magnets in it instead of 4 for double the magnet grip. And in accordance with that, we have a new version of the cradle itself. So let me first break the supports out of the magnet slots. These are really easy to break out. The supports are very tiny things. Two of them came out automatically just by themselves as I was lifting the part out. And then we'll break out the supports for the screw wells. right, we'll come back later to super glue some magnets in. These magnets were purchased on Amazon. They're very affordable. Comes in a pack of 200 of them. And they are nominally listed as 2 millimeters thick by 5 millimeters in diameter. They're slightly less than that in the actual size. That seems pretty common with magnet listings. All right, let's get the supports off of this cradle. First, we should be able to just snap them loose very easily. The back one may be a little bit more tricky. And then we may need a little bit of cleanup right along here and right along here. I don't think I'm going to bother with that for now unless I decide later that it's just troubling me. And as you can see, this also has places where 8 of the tiny magnets go. So I have a feeling I'm going to like this one much better. It already works good even before I put the magnets in, and the magnets are going to really give it that little extra grip that I want. I also wanted a little something so that if I accidentally bumped it from the side, it wouldn't be as easy to accidentally bump it loose off of the cradle. So I think this is going to be good. Hey, future me here. Just wanted to mention that after I got this put together and used it some, I found that where the magnetic grip was stronger than the super glue, you could actually have the magnet from one side pull the magnet out of the socket on the other side. And the way that I have fixed that is I'm editing the design to put the magnets in from the underside of the cradle and in from the inside of the bottom of the case, so that the magnets that are attracting to each other will always have one thin layer of printed plastic between them. So their attraction actually pulls them into their respective sockets rather than tempting one of the magnets to be pulled out of its socket. So hopefully by the time this video gets published, I'll already have that new version of the printable file uploaded and ready. So there are pros and cons to both ways of doing it. With the magnets immediately touching each other, you get the maximum sticking power, but you have the risk that one magnet will pull another magnet loose from the glue, which did happen to me. By putting the magnets in from the underside of the cradle and from the inside of the bottom of the case, the magnets cannot be pulled out of their sockets, but the holding power is reduced slightly. I've left both versions available on my printables, and you can pick which one you want based on what's more important to you. So just as before, I do need to cut a notch to let my USB pigtail, my USB patch cable here that I'm using to update the firmware, because the fluid dial firmware is still under development. And so just as on the previous two, I cut a notch, I need to do that now on the new one. Thank you. mentioned before, there is a hole under here that's made for running a zip tie through, but I'm using a braid twist tie instead of a zip tie. That's probably good enough. Alright, let's get this mounted on the lowrider. First, we'll take this old one off. These are tapered head screws to be countersunk. They're about 16 millimeters long. You can adjust the length as needed depending on the thickness of your YZ. And I think they are, counting the threads, I think they measure about 3 1/4 millimeters in diameter. All right, so here is our fluid dial pendant. And if you bump that from the side, you're not going to knock it off. You've got to be deliberately wanting to get it out. It's easy to position it on the bottom lip and let it just drop in or twist in from the side. The magnets help with alignment. So this is a beta build and developer build of the firmware for the fluid dial. And it is a build that can actually run G-code. You can browse to the SD card, select a G-code file, preview the first few lines of the G-code file to make sure it's the right one, and then actually run the G-code file. So this was a job that I did. This is a file that I used for a job that I did cutting torsion box ribs and spars. And you can see here, it's got a progress bar and a feed rate override, an e-stop button, a hold button, a back button for backing out of this. The state of the machine is in run right now as compared to idle or alarm or some other status. So I've got a green run at the top. Notice that the DROs are steadily updating. And I mean, even if the dev team never did anything better than this version right here, this is still amazingly powerful. They've made quite a few improvements since this version, and they're working to get it all pulled together into one that can be considered ready for, you know, public hobby use. But I'm so impressed with the FluidNC dev team and the firmware that they've created for this dial pendant. And I've contributed both in a donation and also trying to help out with their workload. I would encourage any of you that benefit from their work, either by the FluidNC firmware that powers our Jackpot boards, or the firmware that powers the dial pendant, the fluid dial pendant, to please consider contributing. it's an encouragement to them, and it helps them to be able to purchase the equipment needed for testing their firmware programming. This is Doug with DesignH Studio, and until the next video, I wish you happy making.